I got my start actually hacking over the phone. There's a competition where you have to call up a real company target and you have to hack that company live over the phone in 20 minutes. And I ended up getting second place in that competition 3 years in a row, very consistent second place. And people were like, hey, can you come talk to my company about how you hack? I'm like, sure, why not? So over time, talk to more and more companies. Over time, it's folks like the Air Force and Google and Facebook and Twitter. It just keeps going. And they're like, okay, so we did an event 3, 6, 8 months ago. Can you roll out some videos? I'm like, sure. So I start making videos for companies. And then I'm like, let's do something really wild. I have a background in musical theater, improv. I'm like just a wacky character. And I have a background in neuroscience. That's what I studied. I was like, let's do something that's like uniquely us, right? So I rolled out the InfoSec sea shanty. I don't know if anybody's seen that. But basically, the sea shanties were trending on TikTok. And of course, I'm, you know, watching all the trends. And I was like, let's make a multi-factor authentication password management sea shanty song. And we'll release it to the world for free. And we did this with the community. We had 30 different hackers contribute to it. And it went viral. It got like 400,000 views pretty quickly. About 100 different CISOs reached out and were like, can we use this video, this song in our security awareness training? And I was like, yeah, of course, absolutely. And then they were like, well, that worked. We've been pulling teeth to try and migrate to whatever, you know, multi-factor authentication tool or password management tool. And people just weren't getting it. They weren't getting the why. A quick song, that worked enough. So can you make more songs? So then we rolled out basically an entire album of music videos and spoken word content. And yeah, that's what
security doesn't need to be boring.
No, it doesn't need to be boring. It doesn't need to be like terrifying either. Yeah, it'd be fun. Well, a lot of the changes have to do with remote work under COVID conditions. So we're seeing that folks, because they're not sitting next to you anymore and they can't just go, Ronnie, did you just send me this email? What's this email about?
Yeah.
Right? That's how we used to authenticate things as being legitimate. We used to just like walk over and be like, hey, Mary, quick question about that Slack or quick question about that email or call. Now we have to actually jump on a call, get on an email, Slack, chat, whatever, to verify something is authentic before taking an action, like clicking, downloading, sending money, sending data. And a lot of people don't do that.
Yeah.
And attackers are starting to realize how lucrative that can be. And so they've built these phishing kits, which have been talked about a lot today already. And now it's basically like a commodity. You know, do you have $90 and an interest in hacking?
Yeah.
Great. You can go ahead and hack some of the most major companies in the world. And so the big changes are just the way we authenticate, how much documentation there is available for these attackers. And basically it's commoditized now and you can purchase the kits online much quicker and much faster at a much more professional level. So the kits have always been around. They are much more professional and they're much more highly documented now. They just work better. This type of stuff, like the Twitter hackers, we know the Uber hacker, those folks, many of the times, it's not that they're not skilled, it's that they're young and they purchased a kit. Or they're young and they're on a forum and somebody said, here's the script I use over the phone, go ahead and try it. And that's easy stuff. I mean, social engineering, it didn't take me that long to get super good at it because it's not that hard to understand.
Right.
It's just convincing someone to do something they probably shouldn't do. So the first thing that I always say is most people reuse their passwords. Even probably the people sitting in this room here today. Most people, even security professionals, even experts, reuse elements of their passwords because we just haven't socialized it 100% yet, that we need to have long, random, unique passwords for every single account, stored in a password manager, hopefully. And that's a big challenge because I can find those passwords leaked online from other data breaches so easily. Go on Dhashed, I do recommend you do this, and just type in your email address or your phone number. Get a sense of what's out there on you for your data breaches. What passwords have you used that are leaked now? How quickly could those be remixed using one of our tools to try and hack into your other accounts? And just get a sense of what's out there on you. I just feel like a lot of people don't understand that. So first, long, random, unique passwords. Second, use multi-factor authentication that matches your threat model. If you are in the public eye, if you have a lot of followers, like if you're on Twitch and you're a streamer, you have a lot of followers on social media, or you're being harassed, like you're a journalist or an activist, it's really essential that you consider yourself to be as highly elevated in your threat model as you actually are. I think a lot of people immediately think, sure, I might be a journalist at XYZ publication, I might be an activist here, but who's gonna come after little old me? Who has the time for it? They have the time. And also, they're not just targeting little old you, they're targeting little old you and everybody else within your organization. And so it's really important to understand that we have to match the MFA to the threat model. If your threat model is elevated, move towards FIDO security keys. Well, we've seen the tech companies get hit really hard recently. So just off the top of my head, we have Uber, Twilio, Cloudflare, the Okta situation, Twitter, if I already said that, yep. And it's just hitting these organizations super hard because they're so large and they rely on technology so exclusively and they're so remote that there's so many people with so much access and credential. Like we know in the Twitter hack, there were like 5,000 employees and contractors who had admin level access.
Yeah.
That's a lot of people that I can pop and gain access to what I need on the admin panel. So it's just that kind of diffuse level of access really changes things when it comes to tech companies. But tech companies aren't the only folks that are targeted. I mean, we have manufacturing, which is getting hit super hard right now. Education, schools.
Yeah.
And I think there's a big gap in the schooling world between where people want to be with their security and where they currently are. Teachers, I actually used to be a teacher. When I was a teacher, it was not something that was taught to us. How do I secure my classroom? How do I secure the children in my classroom and the parents? And I feel like there's an absolutely massive gap there. And these are people that really want to learn and want to understand. They just don't have access to those resources right now. I'm an optimist, but I like to be real at the same time. We have seen the folks who have gotten access to things like Uber and Twitter. They had kind of silly intentions. They're kind of messing around and they wanted a lot of cred online. They wanted to feel cool. They wanted to feel interesting. What scares me is the things that they could have done.
Yeah.
So when the Twitter hack happened, they got admin access. They could have disrupted our democracy. They could have changed the way that we fundamentally trust our banking systems. They could have moved markets. That's not what we saw, really. What we saw was kind of silliness and crypto scams, right? And this attack that happened at Uber, the attacker got in and they just weren't quite sure what to do with it. Great. That's what I love to see, right? Somebody who I believe is a minor, who's like, I'm just messing around. I want some cred, right? Got access and was like, do you guys have any ideas? Not quite sure what to do. Maybe I can exfiltrate some data. Maybe I'll take some screenshots. Maybe I'll talk to some reporters. Imagine somebody who was like, I'm going to get access to all of the locations that everybody has been picked up and dropped off. And I'm going to get all the addresses of all the people with high threat models, right? Could have done something really targeted and really scary. And this type of data, these types of threats are available for most companies because most companies collect too much data and store it unencrypted. And so for me, my big fear is we're gonna continue to see these types of attacks, but the attackers are gonna have more and more specific motives. And they're going to go after stuff that's really scary, you know? And I really, it's important to me. That's why I always talk about it. If you can roll out a FIDO security key for people who have admin access, you're gonna stop the attacker in their tracks. The difference between the Twilio hack and Cloudflare, they got hacked at the exact same time with the exact same method, the exact same pretext. The only difference is Cloudflare didn't get popped because they had a FIDO security key. They had their credentials stolen. Three people fell for it. The attacker couldn't go forward. That's the only difference.